All right. Hello, everybody. And here we are on explore number two of periodic trends. Let's go ahead and get down to business here. Okay. Drawing our Cornell note lines. Today, Tuesday, 11/7/23. And we'll go ahead and draw this down like this. Okay. Essential question that we're answering today. How can the observed periodic trends and reactivity of the elements be explained? Okay, so yeah, in Explorer 1, we observed some general trends. Now we're going to try to explain why. Okay. Good morning. Okay, so we got our essential question written out there, got our lines, and let's see what we're looking at here. As we look on the left, we can see electron configurations and the periodic table. We talk about energy levels. Looks like there's that repeat glitch. We have valence electrons and reactivity we're going to talk about. Explaining trends group by group, and explaining trends period to period. So it looks like there's definitely four sections to our notes today. Okay, and remember, this is good reading strategies. You're kind of previewing your text and getting an idea of what you're looking at. So let's start with another good habit. What do you know about this? Okay, what I already know. Take a moment, write yourself a sentence, okay? I'll be grading these in your notebook checks, and obviously we want you to interact with your notes. Every day you should be interacting and checking your understanding and growing that way. Okay, so Roman numeral one is electron configurations. And the periodic table. At this point, you should be thinking of things like electron shells, orbitals, sp, df kinds of shape orbitals, valence shells, that kind of stuff, right? Okay. After having read, and I trust you've read all of Explore 2, and I'm going to say right now, pause and actually read Explore 2 and watch some videos before you continue with these notes. Okay. Paragraph 2, periods correspond to the energy levels occupied by electrons. Paragraph 3, elements in each group have the same number of electrons in their outermost energy level. We know that. We've learned that. In fact, we kind of predicted that that's what was going to be mentioned here. So periods correspond to the energy levels occupied by the electrons. Remember, there were seven periods. Right, so you have seven energy levels. Okay, just a little refresher. And then we also have this, elements in each group uh, have the same number of electrons in their outermost energy level, their valence. Elements in each group have the same number of electrons in their outermost energy level. What we would refer to as their valence, right? Okay, so far nothing really new here. And here we go, that repeat of text, right? All right, so here we go into valence electrons and reactivity. So this, let's go ahead and write down as Roman numeral 2. Okay, Roman numeral 2. Okay, so valence electrons and reactivity. First paragraph, the outermost electrons of an atom are called the valence electrons. True, we know that. These are the electrons involved in chemical reactions. We've talked about that as well. Check, we know that. Elements tend to react with one another to either donate, take, or share electrons in order to achieve a filled outer energy level. This makes them more stable. All right. So let's just go ahead and summarize that quickly, okay? So we're going to say valence electrons are involved in chemical reactions. Okay, we're going to try to keep this as direct as possible. In chemical reactions. Okay, and as you know, you can either gain electrons, lose electrons, share electrons. We're not talking about metallic bonds here. Number one, or we'll put here. Elements tend to gain, lose, or share electrons in order to achieve a full valence. This is important. This makes them more stable. Thus, making them more stable. Right, thus making the atoms more stable. Okay, so we have some general trends here that maybe you start to pick up on just in our discussions. Metals on the left-hand side of the periodic table, they tend to, what does our text say? They tend to lose electrons. Okay, these are metals. And non-metals, what do they tend to do? They tend to gain electrons. All of this is in order to achieve a full outer level, okay? And what does it say? It is this tendency to gain or lose electrons that determines how reactive an element is. The greater the tendency to gain or lose, the more reactive the element. Okay, so let's put down number two here. Metals tend to lose electrons, okay? And remember, metals are on the little side note here. Where are metals? We're thinking to ourselves, left side of periodic table, right? So if you're in group number one, which is going to open up a periodic table here. If you're in group number one, you have only one valence electron. So it's probably easier for you just to lose one valence electron and achieve a full valence by dropping down an energy level. Group two, you'd have to lose two electrons, still relatively the more energetically favorable way to go, and drop down an energy level and have your full valence. Okay. On the other side here, as they're getting ready to mention here, these guys over here tend to gain electrons. The non-metals, right? That's going to be especially this stuff over here, right? Especially this stuff. They tend to gain electrons. Okay, so especially halogens, they have seven. They only need one more electron to get a full valence. So they're going to gain one, right? They're going to gain one. The group 16, they have six electrons. They only need two more. Most likely they're going to gain two electrons. Okay, group 15, they only need three more. They're most likely going to gain those three. Okay, so that's kind of what your text is trying to go for here. So metals tend to lose electrons, and versus non-metals, which tend to gain electrons. Okay, and again, if we were to go back over here and use, let's just use fluorine as an example. Okay, i.e. fluorine. Fluorine has 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Most likely, it just needs to gain one electron. Okay, and if we look at our example of something on the metal side here, let's go ahead and just take lithium, okay, and we'll say... we'll go here and we're going to say example i.e. lithium. Lithium has two energy levels, and in its outer shell it has one electron. Okay, so there's its first energy level. Here's its second energy level. It only has one electron in here. So, and then it has two electrons in here. So it's easier for this guy just to lose, easier to lose one electron and be stable, right? Because you can have a maximum of two electrons in your first orbit and still be stable, okay? All right, so that's kind of where your text is going with that. All right, we're going to clear everything here. Clear screen. And let's move on. So now let's go ahead and try to explain. This is going to be Roman numeral 3. So I'm going to just draw my line down here. Okay, just going to keep this going here. Roman numeral 3, 1, 2, 3. And what is this going to be about? Explaining trends in chemical reactivity from group to group. Okay. And let's see here. The general, looking at paragraph one, the general pattern of reactivity seen between elements within the same group can be explained by this similarity in valence electrons. So that's really it. The fact that they all have similar valence electrons. That's the key there. Okay. Capital A. The general pattern of reactivity seen between elements within the same group can be explained by this similarity in valence electrons. Okay, so remember our example of fluorine. We said that fluorine over here, I'll clear a screen and let's just kind of move over here, was in group 17. Well, all of these guys have a valence of 7 electrons. So all of them only need one electron to gain stability. And if we go over here and take a look at this side, all of these guys in group 1 have one valence electron. Hydrogen needs one just to fill its first shell and have two. And lithium through francium have one electron. And so its tendency will be to lose that one electron. Okay. So that's kind of it. You're looking just vertically down the groups for those trends. Okay. And so paragraph 2, they're looking at the alkali metals because they have only one s orbital electron to lose to achieve a filled outer energy level. These elements lose their electron readily. This explains their high reactivity. Okay. This explains their high reactivity. Okay. So let's just say example. Okay. Number 1, the alkali metals group 1. Alkali metals. What do we know about them? They have one electron in their outermost energy level. Because they have only one s orbital electron to lose to achieve a filled outer energy level, these elements lose this electron readily. Okay, so we'll just go ahead and add that in their outermost energy level. And which one is it for this one? It's the s orbital. Okay. They have one electron in their outermost energy level. And therefore, will readily lose it. Okay, that'll give them the full, give them a full valence by losing it, and this explains the high reactivity. Okay. In the case of transition metals, so now they're moving us over into these guys right over here. Now we're going to talk about the transition guys, right? And including these guys, right? What do they say about this? The tendency to react is much less. Ah, interesting. So we've gone from alkali metals, and now we're talking about group 2. Transition metals, hopefully I didn't say group 2. We're actually talking about what would be the 2B grouping, right? The tendency to react is much less. And as you can see in yellow, most of these elements have filled s-p orbitals. Only their d orbitals are partially filled, and it is energetically less favorable for atoms with partially filled d orbitals to react. As a result, these metals are comparatively stable. That's an interesting point, okay? Because most of these elements have filled s and p orbitals. Only their d orbitals are partially filled. Okay, and it is, what does it say about that? And it's energetically less favorable with partially filled d orbitals to react. And it is energetically unfavorable to react when you have partially filled D's, okay? Now let's go all the way to the right-hand side of our periodic table, and they'll talk about nonmetals. With respect to nonmetals, the most reactive elements are the halogens, all right? So we're talking about right now, if we clear our screen here, we're talking about group number 7, the halogens, group 17, the halogens, right? So number 3, nonmetals. The most reactive, we're going to write this down here. The most reactive are the halogens. This is our number 17, or 7a, right? They gain one electron to form a filled outer energy level. We talked about that. Okay, so we're going to say A halogens group 17 are most reactive because they only need one electron to become stable. Okay, nonmetals in group 15 must gain 3, and those in group 16 must gain 2, which can happen, but it's just less likely to happen. Okay, that makes these less reactive. Okay, so as you move left, as you move left, things become less reactive. Less reactive. Okay, that's kind of what your text is saying there. Versus group 16, which needs 2 electrons, and group 15, which needs 3 electrons. Can it happen? Yes, it's just energetically less favorable. All right, I'm going to pause for a second. Okay, so the pattern, here we are, taking a look at this paragraph right here. The pattern that emerges from these observations is that for many atoms, the closer the atom is to being able to achieve valence electrons, 8, in its s and p orbitals, the more reactive it is. That's pretty important right there. Okay, we're going to write that down. So how do we want to say this exactly? 3A, I guess we could call this B right here, okay? 3B here. Okay, B. B. The closer the atom is to being able to achieve 8 valence electrons in its s and p orbitals, the more reactive it is. Okay, that's kind of an important piece right there. Okay, so let's see if we can. I didn't like that, whatever I just did there. All right, well, that's it there. Okay. Okay, got some good videos here. And explaining trends from period to period, I think this is the last part we have to do. We saw that reactivity increases as we go down in a group of metals and decreases as we go down in a group of nonmetals. Why do we have this opposite kind of thing? That's what you should be asking yourself. Why opposite behavior? Okay. And the answer is right here. The answer has to do with the ease of gain or loss of a valence electrons by an element. Okay. So I think what we need to do is we're going to put down a Roman numeral 4. This is our last point. Roman numeral 4. Trends explaining trends in chemical reactivity, this time from period to period. Not sure what just happened there. From period to period. Right. So let's see here. Let me pause for a second. Okay, just had to plug that in. All right, so why does reactivity increase as we go down A group. Of metals, but decrease as we go down a group of non-metals. And the reason has to do with whether they're going to gain or lose electrons. Has to do with the ease of gaining or losing electrons. Okay, and they're going to explain in paragraph 3, we can take the alkali metal group as an example. As we move down this group, the number of energy levels increases. As these energy levels add layers to the structure of the atom, the valence electrons that are located farther away from the positively charged nucleus, the valence electrons are located further away from the positively charged nucleus. More electrons are present in the inner energy levels, and these inner energy electrons shield, that's a key word there, shield the outer electrons from the positive nuclear charge. With so much shielding, the valence electrons have less pull from the nucleus and can move away with greater ease. Because the alkali metals lose electrons to achieve stability, greater shielding results in greater reactivity. All right, so we're talking about your alkali metals, okay? And we're talking about group one, okay? So let's just take a look at lithium, okay? So example, okay? Group one. And we'll start with lithium, okay? Lithium has two shells. One. Two. The lithium has three protons, so it has, I'll write these in blue, it has one, two, three. And it has electrons. It has one electron, negatively charged, two electrons, and three electrons, okay? So what you see here is you see that you have three positive charges, attract the outer electron. Versus, as you go all the way down, right? So we just did, we just were looking at lithium. Versus, let's just go all the way to, let's go to cesium, okay? Versus cesium, Cs. And cesium has six shells. Oh my gosh, I'm gonna have to create quite a bit of room here for this one. Cesium. It has, and cesium has 55 protons. Okay, that's a lot of positive charge. Okay, I'm not going to draw them all, but you get the idea. There's a lot, and I've got to draw six shells. The first shell, the second shell, the third shell, fourth shell, fifth shell, sixth shell. And that sixth shell has only one electron in it, right? Now there's a lot of other electrons, right? Man, there's a lot of electrons. One, these are all electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And then they start to get bigger than this. Okay, but the point here is that there's a lot of shielding going on. So what I want to say here, all of these electrons, let's see if I can pick a different color here. Okay. These electrons act like a shield, This positive is, trying to attract, the electron, right? This electron is being blocked. The positive is trying to pull this electron. The electron doesn't want to get pulled very easily, okay? So the electron is blocked from the positive nucleus and can easily be lost. Okay, that this is the whole concept of electron shielding. Okay, so this is electron shielding. Okay. Now, let's go back to our text because they explain with the halogens a slightly different model here. If we examine the halogens, the nonmetals, however, gain electrons to achieve stability instead of losing them, and the increase in shielding decreases the reactivity in the lower periods of a group because the pool of the nucleus is limited. All right, so let's go ahead and draw this, okay? This is going to be example group one, and now we're going to take a look at group our halogens for what group? Group 17. Okay, so we're going to say versus group 17. Example group 17, which are nonmetals. Okay. And we can go ahead and say we use fluorine as an example. We have fluorine. Fluorine has 9. And fluorine is also in group number 2. So it has 2 energy levels. But fluorine has 7 valence electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Okay? And let's go ahead and just draw one. Let's try bromine. Okay, we'll draw versus bromine. Versus Br. Okay. Bromine has 35. That's a lot. I'm not going to draw them all. That's good enough. And bromine is in the 4th, and it has 7. All right, so you got to draw 4 shells. 1, 2, 3, 4. And on its outside one, it has 7 electrons again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. All right, so let's go back to the text. Okay, we've kind of drawn this out. The nonmetals, however, gain electrons, right? This guy needs to gain one. Let's write a note there. needs to gain one electron, right? To achieve stability. And the increase in shielding, right? This is the shielding, decreases the reactivity in the lower periods of the group because the pool of the nucleus is limited. Okay, so the, I'm gonna underline this here, decreases the reactivity in the lower periods. So who's going to have decreased reactivity? This guy will have decreased. Well, actually, let me actually change that because I'm kind of saying that wrong for you. Lower periods. Okay, so this would be a lower period, right? This would be like period four, a lower period. This is a lower period. This lower, okay. In the lower periods, because the pull of the nucleus is limited. So again, there's, this nucleus is trying to pull, electrons, but there's a lot of electrons blocking. So these guys are block the pool, so it can't attract electrons easily. And that's why reactivity decreases as you go down, Okay. All right. I think that that's it. So what I would really suggest you do right now, there's a lot to kind of absorb in your brain. Go ahead and write yourself a summary sentence right now, okay? There we go. Let me just get this centered here, and I'm going to draw a line. And write yourself a summary sentence now, okay? All right. We'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.